Sometimes it causes me to tremble, tremble, tremble. Were you there when God raised him from the tomb?
Please stand. Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the entrance. But when they entered, they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. They saw a young man dressed in a white robe sitting on the right side, and they were alarmed. "Don't be alarmed," he said. "You are looking for Jesus the Nazarene who was crucified. He has risen. He is not here." So the women hurried away from the tomb, afraid yet filled with joy, and ran to tell his disciples. Mary Magdalene went to the disciples with the news, "I have seen the Lord." People of God, why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here, for he has risen. The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Alleluia, Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Alleluia.
Oh,
The stone has been rolled away. Alleluia.
The crucified is risen. Alleluia.
In his great mercy, God has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead.
For Christ must reign until he has put all his enemies under his feet. The last enemy to be destroyed is death.
God raised him from the dead, freeing him from the agony of death, because it was impossible for death to keep its hold on him.
Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live, even though he dies, and whoever lives and believes in me will never die.
As we gather for worship on this day of the resurrection, we call on the name of the only living God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Brothers and sisters in Christ, this morning we walk with the women to the garden graveyard, to the place that has transformed our world and our own life. This is where we meet the risen Lord Jesus, who was victorious over sin, death, and the devil. We come to him now, confessing our sins and seeking his gracious forgiveness. With sincere hearts and minds, let us confess our sins.
Forgive us, Lord, and have mercy upon us. Forgive our self-centered rebellion against you and our lack of love for others. Roll away the stone of sin and the hardness of our own hearts and lives.
Jesus has carried our sins to his own death. In your baptism, your sinful nature was united to the death of Jesus, and you were raised to new life. You are a new creation in Christ Jesus. Alleluia! In Jesus' name and by the power of his resurrection, and as a called and ordained servant of the Word, I forgive you all your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen.
We have been forgiven.
We have been restored
to new life in Christ.
Alleluia. You may be seated. Almighty God, through your only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, you overcame death and open to us the gate of everlasting life. We humbly pray that we may live before you in righteousness and purity forever, through the same Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. The Old Testament reading on this Easter Sunday taken from Exodus chapter 14. When Pharaoh drew near, the people of Israel lifted up their eyes, and behold, the Egyptians were marching after them, and they feared greatly. And the people of Israel cried out to the Lord. They said to Moses, "Is it because there are no graves in Egypt that you have taken us away to die in the wilderness? What have you done to us in bringing us out of Egypt? Is not this what we said to you in Egypt? Leave us alone, that we may serve the Egyptians. For it would have been better for us to serve the Egyptians than to die in the wilderness." And Moses said to the people, "Fear not, stand firm, and see the salvation of the Lord, which he will work for you today. For the Egyptians whom you see today, you shall never see again. The Lord will fight for you, and you have only to be silent." The Lord said to Moses, "Why do you cry to me? Tell the people of Israel to go forward. Lift up your staff and stretch out your hand over the sea and divide it, that the people of Israel may go through the sea on dry ground. And I will harden the hearts of the Egyptians so that they shall go in after them, and I will get glory over Pharaoh and all his hosts, his chariots and his horsemen. And the Egyptians shall know that I am the Lord, when I have gotten glory over Pharaoh, his chariots, and his horsemen." Then the angel of God who was going before the host of Israel moved and went behind them, and the pillar of cloud moved from before them and stood behind them, coming between the host of Egypt and the host of Israel. And there was the cloud and the darkness, and it lit up the night without one coming near the other all night. Then Moses stretched out his hand over the sea, and the Lord drove the sea back by a strong east wind all night and made the sea dry land, and the waters were divided. And the people of Israel went into the midst of the sea on dry ground, the waters being a wall to them on their right hand and on their left. The Egyptians pursued and went in after them into the midst of the sea, all Pharaoh's horses, his chariots, and his horsemen. And in the morning watch, the Lord in the pillar of fire and of cloud looked down on the Egyptian forces and threw the Egyptian forces into a panic, clogging their chariot wheels so that they drove heavily. And the Egyptians said, "Let us flee from before Israel, for the Lord fights for them against the Egyptians." Then the Lord said to Moses, "Stretch out your hand over the sea, that the water may come back upon the Egyptians, upon their chariots and upon their horsemen." So Moses stretched out his hand over the sea, and the sea returned to its normal course when the morning appeared. And as the Egyptians fled into it, the Lord threw the Egyptians into the midst of the sea. The waters returned and covered the chariots and the horsemen. Of all the host of Pharaoh that had followed them into the sea, not one of them remained. But the people of Israel walked on dry ground through the sea, the waters being a wall to them on their right hand and on their left. Thus the Lord saved Israel that day from the hand of the Egyptians, and Israel saw the Egyptians dead on the seashore. Israel saw the great power that the Lord used against the Egyptians, so the people feared the Lord, and they believed in the Lord and in his servant Moses. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
The epistle reading today from 1 Corinthians chapter 15. Now I would remind you, brothers, of the gospel I preached to you, which you received, in which you stand, and by which you are being saved, if you hold fast to the word I preached to you, unless you believed in vain. For I delivered to you as of first importance what I also received, that Christ died for our sins in accordance with the Scriptures, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures, and that he appeared to Cephas and then to the 12. Then he appeared to more than 500 brothers at one time, most of whom are still living, though some have fallen asleep. Then he appeared to James, then to all the apostles. Last of all, as to one untimely born, he appeared also to me. For I am the least of the apostles, unworthy to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God, I am what I am, and his grace toward me was not in vain. On the contrary, I worked harder than any of them, though it was not I, but the grace of God that is with me. Whether then it was I or they, so we preach, and so you believed. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Please stand.
Hallelujah, Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. Hallelujah, hallelujah.
The Holy Gospel according to St. John, 20th chapter. Now on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb early while it was still dark and saw that the stone had been taken away from the tomb. So she ran and went to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one whom Jesus loved, and said to them, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him." So Peter went out with the other disciple, and they were going toward the tomb. Both of them were running together, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. And stooping to look in, he saw the linen cloths lying there, but he did not go in. Then Simon Peter came following him and went into the tomb. He saw the linen cloths lying there, and the face cloth, which had been on Jesus' head, not lying with the linen cloths, but folded up in a place by itself. Then the other disciple, who had reached the tomb first, also went in, and he saw and believed. For as yet they did not understand the scripture that he must rise from the dead. Then the disciples went back to their homes. But Mary stood weeping outside the tomb, and as she wept, she stooped to look into the tomb, and she saw two angels in white sitting where the body of Jesus had lain, one at the head and one at the feet. They said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" She said to them, "They have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him." Having said this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing, but she did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you seeking?" Supposing him to be the gardener, she said to him, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned and said to him in Aramaic, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus said to her, "Do not cling to me, for I have not ascended yet to the Father, but go to my brothers and say to them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God." Mary Magdalene went and announced to the disciples, "I have seen the Lord," and that he had said these things to her. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. You may be seated.
Peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and risen Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Dear Christian friends, watching the sun rise is a beautiful moment. The reason you might be awake to see it isn't always, but seeing the sunrise is beautiful. When I was a student at Concordia University, Wisconsin, down in Mequon, I think every student who came there was told to go out and see the sunrise at least once. The reason we were always told this is because of our location. Concordia is right on the edge of Lake Michigan, with a bluff that goes straight down to the water on campus. So, if you got up early enough, you would not only get to watch the sunrise, you would get to watch the beauty of it happen over the open water. While I wasn't an early riser during that time, I did see the sunrise several times while I was there. A few of them may have been because of late nights that turned into early mornings from doing schoolwork, but nevertheless, the sunrise was still just as beautiful on those days. So this morning, we gather at this time to experience the sunrise together. Both the physical sun rising in the sky, but also the rising of God's only Son. Just a few days ago, we heard the story once again of how our King was betrayed, beaten, and killed all for you. While we left him in the tomb looking like he had been defeated, this morning we get to celebrate with the victory that is clear to see. Early on that first Easter morning, at a time much like this, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb of Jesus. Just like any normal person would, she was expecting to find the body still placed inside, lying perfectly still. What a shock it would have been for her then when she goes in and sees that he's gone. The stone is rolled away, and the tomb is empty. Of course, she didn't understand that Jesus had risen from the dead. That probably wouldn't have been anyone's first idea. With worry of what happened, thinking someone took the body, she ran back to the disciples to tell them what she found, an empty tomb. At that news, all the disciples came, and they started to run to see the truth for themselves, and as they arrived, they saw, too, that he wasn't there. All they saw was an empty tomb. Jesus had told them time and time again that he was going to raise from the dead, but they didn't quite understand. So on their return home, I wonder what they were thinking about, what could have possibly happened. Well, that is, except for Mary. Because Mary didn't leave. She stayed at the tomb, and she wept for her king and her friend. The long night that she had been living through wasn't over. To her, it looked like Jesus was still dead, and now his body was gone too. To her, it looked like Jesus was dead, so she wept and she went in one more time just to make sure that he really wasn't there. When she went in, though, she no longer found an empty tomb, but two angels sitting there. When they asked her who she was looking for, she told them she was looking for Jesus. At this, she turned around to leave the tomb, and who stood there but Jesus? Yet she didn't recognize him yet. For just one more moment, she was still in the dark. During my breaks from Concordia, Wisconsin, especially over my summers, I worked at Mercury Marine in Fond du Lac. Almost every summer, I worked third shift, which could be a hard transition from the normal schedule if you've ever experienced yourself. For a few months, I would leave behind the land of the living to sleep all day and work all night in the dark. In the part of the factory I worked in, I would pass this loading dock we had frequently, and there were these three large garage doors that let you see straight out over the parking lot. On those hot summer nights, those garage doors would remain open to help us cool off, but they also served another purpose, letting all of us catch a glimpse of what was outside. As I worked through the night, you were waiting for those signs that your shift was finally coming to an end. You'd see the first shift people starting to come in at one point, and the clock would tell you around when you were going to be done. But the first sign every night that you were almost done was watching the sunrise through those doors. The sight of the sunrise those nights was the sign that the night was over and we were going to be out of the dark. Sunrise like this was always the sign that it was over, that the darkness was coming to an end. And darkness is something we're all well acquainted with. I'm not just talking about physical darkness, like what we find in the night. I'm talking about a spiritual darkness of the evils we face and hear every day. Praying at the prayer vigil over the last 2 days will make you keenly aware of all the darkness that surrounds people here and all the struggles we go through. The diseases you and your loved ones suffer from, the hate and the violence we see carried out in the world, the selfishness and evil that we see running rampant around us. All this surrounds us and makes us feel like we're still in the dark. Yet it is in that darkness that the light shines forth. For Mary, outside of the tomb, that comes when Jesus speaks just one word to her, her name. When she hears him speak her name, it is the sun finally rising, and she can clearly see who it is who's standing in front of him. And just like any normal person would, with all of the excitement she has from the sorrow that's gone away, she clings on to Jesus, hugging him as tightly as she can. The person she thought was dead is risen. The king is victorious, and he wants others to know about it. Jesus tells Mary that she can let him go. He isn't leaving quite yet. He's got other people that he wants to know about what he's done. And so she tells him to go to the disciples. And she does. Just like before, she runs to tell them what she saw. An empty tomb. A risen king. And in our darkness, that light shines forth too. When we hear the news that Mary first shared on that first Easter morning. The sun is risen. Mary has seen the Lord. Death could not hold him. The devil had no power over him. Nothing could, can, and will ever overcome him. He is risen, and he wants the world to know. The world that is engulfed in darkness is not outside of his nail-pierced hands. Jesus, the King, is reigning over it all. And Easter isn't the end for us. While today is a day of victory, there is another day we wait for. The day when he will return and we too will see him face to face, just like Mary did. On that day, Jesus will return for another resurrection. Not for his, but for yours. On that day, victory will be seen once again as death is shown powerless and we and our loved ones are raised from the dead to be with him for all eternity. Yet that day is one we still wait for. That is a sunrise we can't wait to see. So as we wait, he sends us out to tell others, just like he did Mary. And while today you may gather with your family and friends, we can still share the news of what happened today. And we can do it every day. We can tell them to come see the empty tomb. Come see what he's done for me and for you. And have no fear. The one who rules over everything, all of creation, he cares for you. He was risen for you. The one who rules went to the cross and rose again this morning, all for you. So that you may be out of the darkness and in the light with him for all eternity. Sunrises are a beautiful sight. Each morning they bring an end to the darkness. It lights our paths in the street, giving us a safe way to go, and it brings a sense of peace in the midst of it all. And each day, when the sun rises, it serves as a reminder of what happened this morning. The Son of God is risen, and he still reigns. Alleluia, Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed. Alleluia.
Amen. Please stand. Now may the peace which passes all understanding guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Amen. We continue by confessing our shared faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
You may be seated, and at this time we bring forward the offering today. And just a reminder, if you haven't been here lately, that the offering plates are at the doors. There's also ways to give online as noted. If you're visiting with us today, there's certainly no expectation to give. But we do thank you for your support as members of this church. King Jesus, we give thanks that you did indeed defeat sin, death, and hell through your resurrection. And because of this day, we have hope, and we also have that assurance of salvation, the forgiveness of our sins, and the resurrection to look forward to when you return. Please use these offerings, these gifts, these tithes that we have made to you, that your work might continue to be done in this community, as well as throughout the world, that more people may know you, believe in you and your resurrection, and be saved. In Jesus' name, amen. In our prayers today, we want to add a few additions to those prayers that are listed in your bulletin in the prayer box. We want to include a prayer for Cooper Warren, infant son of Josh and Emily, as Cooper's hospitalized in Marshfield. Also for Millie Strobel in her health concerns, and for her friends and family, Luann Gelhausen, friend of Gary and Deanna Keeper. And also we pray God's comfort for the family of Ron Fisher, brother of Pat Fisher, as Ron passed away yesterday. We pray the Easter prayer of joy. Lord God, Heavenly Father, thank you for taking the cross of Jesus Christ, your Son, and turning his seeming defeat into victory by raising him from the dead. You roll the stone away so that we may live in the light and truth of his Easter victory. Give to us joy, O Lord, that we may look to Jesus, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is seated at the right hand of the throne of God. Give to us the joy of the open tomb, O risen Lord. God of all grace, your care for us knows no limits. When we mourn, you comfort us. When we suffer, you strengthen us. When we are ill, you heal us and help us to endure. Hear our prayers for those in need this day, including our peace family members, Jack Greening, Tom Locke, Gary Camps, Connie Broomer, Cooper Warren, and Millie Strobel. We also pray for our family and friends, including Liam Hayek, Jan Young, John Faller, Clarence Guralski, and also Luann Gelhausen. And we pray, Lord, your comfort on those who are mourning the loss of loved ones, including the family of Ron Fisher. We pray that you might grant them the comfort that comes in knowing you indeed are risen from the dead. For all these prayers, Lord, and others we may have in our hearts and mind, O risen and ever-present Lord, hear our prayers. Give to us joy, O Lord, all the days of our life, the joy of forgiveness, life, and salvation, and the joy of believing in your resurrection victory. Amen. Please stand as we continue by praying the prayer our Lord Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and glory, forever and ever.
Amen.
The celebration of the Lord's Supper is a gift from Christ to his church in order to strengthen our faith and grant us his grace. Because our participation in this sacrament is a proclamation of our common faith and may be taken either to one's spiritual benefit or harm, guests who hold to a different confession of faith or have yet to complete Lutheran confirmation are invited to come forward for a blessing rather than to receive the supper. This can be done by crossing your hands in front of you as you come forward. We pray. Blessed are you, O Lord, our God, King of all creation, for you have had mercy on us and given your only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. We give you thanks for the redemption you have prepared for us through Jesus Christ. Grant us your Holy Spirit, that we may faithfully eat and drink of your blessings of grace that come to us through faith in him who defeated death and the grave, your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ, in the night in which he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, also, he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This is my blood of the New Testament, shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And now the peace of the Lord be with you always.
Also with you.
You may be seated.
Thank you.
Please stand. Now may this true body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen and keep you in the saving faith until life everlasting. Amen. Let us pray. Gracious God, as we go out with the victorious news that you indeed are risen from the dead, may we live in that victory daily and remember that you are King over our life, both now and for eternity. In Jesus' name, amen. You are invited to take these with you. We don't need them back. These have some announcements as far as what's happening here at Peace going forward. We are starting a new worship series next weekend. It's our Bible Reboot Part 3. But basically what it is what happened after the resurrection? You know, how did it impact the lives of the early church? How did the world change because of today? So we're going to talk about that over the next several weeks. We hope you can join us for those services, 6 p.m. on Saturday, 8 or 10:30 on Sunday. Thank you for those that donated for the flowers up here in the front of the church. And of course, one last announcement, there is an Easter breakfast, all right? And so we've got pancakes, eggs, and sausage, and other goodies. So hopefully you can stay, support our youth program here at Peace Lutheran, and thanks to all the youth and family members who helped put that on today. Let us pray before we have the benediction and ask God's blessing on the meal this morning. All right? Lord Jesus, thank you for making the provisions for our body and life, and thank you especially for providing us salvation accomplished through your resurrection this day. May you bless our time, and we also pray together, come, Lord Jesus, be our guest, and let these gifts to us be blessed. Amen. And now receive the blessing of our Lord. May the Lord bless you and keep you. And for this purpose, Christ came, and for this purpose he died to bring salvation to all. May the Lord who brought salvation to all through the cross and empty tomb bless and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you his peace. Amen.